Hello everyone, I'm Pritha Bhaumik.
And hello, I am Aditya Agarwal.
And we are the legal research interns of Litdroid India, a platform that provides you with legal knowledge through various articles, blogs, lectures and seminars. And today we'll be talking about registration of contracts. First, we'll be discussing about contracts. What is contract? Contract isn't just an associate degree agreement between two parties promising to perform an associate degree act, but rather it is a legally binding agreement that generates rights and obligations that may be implemented by legal action within the course, and this action denotes the registration of contracts. Registration is completed when the parties to the contract execute the document to be registered. Though all contracts are compulsorily agreements, but all agreements are not deemed to be contracts. An agreement so as to be a legitimate contract ought to be registered with the sub-registrar of assurance beneath the provisions of the Indian Registration Act 1908 at an interval of 4 months from the date of execution of the document. Next, we will be discussing about the process concerning registration of contracts. After the registration of an agreement, the sub-registrar verifies the document to determine its lawfulness and checks to confirm the payment of the total stamp duty. In his presence, the parties that have executed the document are summoned to admit that they have registered the aforesaid document. Such parties are then personally identified by two independent witnesses. All the parties and witness are again made to sign before the sub-registrar in a further page hooked up to the document so as to reconfirm the registration. Parties to the document are photographed and their thumb impressions are taken, and such photographs and thumb impressions are pasted on extra pages that are hooked to the document. The sub-registrar then puts his official seal on each page and puts a unique numbering list on each page of the document, including the extra ones. On the last page, he then signs the document as being registered. He records the contents of the document together with the extra pages, either by photocopying the content or by scanning the content of the document. The photocopy or scanned image is for good maintained by him in his records, so in future, whenever a replica of the document is needed, it can be obtained. Also, that document becomes a public document which anybody can inspect by paying the requisite inspection fees. After taking a complete check of the document, as mentioned above, on the record and after completing the above formalities, the original document is returned to the party presenting the document for registration. This completes. Next, we'll be talking about the documents which requires compulsory registration. The documents which must be registered are, number 1, instruments of gift of immovable property under section 17, subsection 1, clause A of the Registration Act 1908. Number 2, instruments under section 17, subsection 1, clause B. Number 3, receipt of consideration under section 17, subsection 1, clause C. Fourth, leases under section 17, subsection 1, clause D. Number 5, transfer of decree, order or award of court under section 17, subsection 1, clause E. And number 6, authority to adopt a son under section 17, subsection. And now we will discuss all these in detail. First, we will be discussing about gift of immovable property under section 17, subsection 1, clause A. It says that the instrument of gift of an immovable property is a mandatorily registerable instrument. Such deed having not been registered cannot de jure, convey right, title or interest in or to immovable property. Under this, we are going to talk about gift under Muslim law. It says that although a gift made under Muslim personal law is expressly excluded from the operation of Section 129 of the Transfer of Property Act 1882, yet it comes within the purview of the Registration Act 1908 and therefore is compulsory registrable. Next, we are going to discuss about instruments under Section 17, Subsection 1, Clause B. It says that other non-testamentary instruments which purport or produce, declare, assign, limit or extinguish whether in present or in future any right, title or interest by the vested or contingent of the worth of 100 rupees or more to or in immovable property shall be registered. Under this, we are going to discuss few illustrations. First, about a mortgage deed. A deed is registerable under this clause. The Section 58 of the Transfer of Property Act 1882 provides that where the amount secured is rupees 100 or upwards, a mortgage can be affected only by a registered instrument. Next, we are going to talk about charge. Documents creating a charge on immovable property of the value of rupees 100 or upwards require registration under this Act. Next, we are going to talk about transfer of redemption. It says that redemption deed for transferring back land valuing more than rupees 100 or upwards require registration. It was a registered mortgage. Next, we are going to talk about instrument of partition. Instrument of partition of immovable property of the value of rupees 100 or upwards is compulsorily registrable under this clause. Next, talking about floating charge, it creates a contingent right and a document creating such charge is registrable under Section 17, Clause A and B. Next, talking about assignment of a household, it says that an assignment of an interest in leasehold property requires registration of the interest assigned of the value of rupees 100 or upwards. And then last but not the least, talking about variation of mortgage, it says that an agreement by which a mortgagor agrees to pay interest at a rate higher than fixed by the mortgage deed, which itself is registered, requires registration. Moving on to number 3, receipt of consideration under Section 17, Subsection 1, Clause C. It says that non-testamentary instruments which recognize the receipt or settlement of any consideration on account of the formation, proclamation, engagement, restriction or extinction of any such right, title or interest shall be registered. We are going to discuss three illustrations under this. First one is of a sale deed. A sale deed requires registration under this clause whereby not only the immovable property is conveyed but the price thereof is also acknowledged. Next, surrender of lands. A receipt acknowledging receipt of consideration of over rupees 100 for surrendering certain lands is compulsorily registerable. Next, receipt for premium. A receipt which purports to be for Nazrana paid for a lease requires registration, but not if the sum is less than rupees 100. Number 4 talks about leases under Section 17, Subsection 1, Clause D. It says that leases of immovable property from year to year or for any term exceeding 1 year or reserving a yearly rent is compulsorily registerable. The duration lease is sole determinant of its registration. In so far as the registration is compulsory, a lease must be year to year or for a term exceeding 1 year or reserving early rents. Now, where no term of lease is specifically fixed and is for an indefinite period, it does not require registration. Proviso Section 17, Subsection 1, Clause D says that the provincial government, according to Proviso of Section 18, Subsection 1, may exempt any leases the terms granted by which do not exceed 5 years and the annual rents reserved by which do not exceed 50 rupees. Next, number 5. Transfer of decree order or award of court under Section 17, Subsection 1, Clause E. In accordance to this clause, non-testamentary instruments transferring or allocating any decree or order of a court or any award when such decree or order or award impersonates or operates to produce, proclaim, assign, restrain or put out, whether in present or in future, any right, title or interest, whether vested or contingent, to the value of 100 rupees and more, to or in an immovable property, shall be registered. Discussing about its illustrations, first we are going to talk about mortgage decree. A mortgage decree must be regarded as in relation to immovable property and is within the clutches of this clause. Next, we are going to discuss about decree creating charge. A decree creating a charge creates a right or immovable property and an assignment thereof comes under Clause C of this section. Next, moving on to number 6, authorities to adopt a son under Section 17, Subsection 3. It says that an authority to adopt a son as distinguished from deed of adoption is compulsorily registerable for the reason that it is not merely a deed but adoption itself that create the status of adopted son and create interest in the property.
So now we move on to our next topic, which is the documents of which registration is not compulsory. Yes, there are several documents which are not required to be registered under Section 17 of the Registration Act. Some of them require high stamp tax under the Karnataka Stamp Act and a few of them don't. Even those which require high stamp tax, if they are understamped, then they are often rectified later by paying a penal amount 10 times the first amount. Non-payment of stamp tax does not make the document void or otherwise invalid. The effects of understamping as per the Stamp Act are: Number 1. To form the document inadmissible for evidence before any authority capable of receiving evidence before any public authority. Number 2. The document can also be confiscated for imposing the payment of full stamp value. An understamped instrument are often admitted as evidence in court if penal stamp tax 10 times the worth of the first amount has to be paid. The list of documents that do not require registration: power of attorney that is given except the power to sell property, development agreement of sale given by a proprietor to a property dealer, lease agreement, leasehold deed for a period less than 1 year, and the memorandum of oral partition recording a past undertaking. So now, moving on with all contracts are agreements, but all agreements are not contracts. This forms the basis for the importance or significance of registration of contracts. The Registration Act 1908 was enacted with the intention of providing orderliness, discipline and public notice in reference to transactions concerning immovable property and protection from fraud and forgery of documents while transfer. This is often achieved by requiring compulsory registration of certain sort of documents and also providing consequences for non-registration. Registration provides safety and security to transactions concerning immovable property if the document is lost or destroyed. It gives publicity and dissemination to documents, thereby preventing forgeries and frauds in reference to transactions and execution of documents. Registration provides information to people that may affect a property on the character and extent of the rights which persons may have affecting that property. In other words, to simplify, it enables people to seek out whether any particular property with which they are concerned has been subjected to any legal obligation or liability, and who is or are the person or people presently having right title and interest within the said property. It provides protection of documents which are of legal importance or relevance by recording them, where people may even see the record and inquire and ascertain what the particulars are and as far as land is concerned, what obligations exist with reference to them. It ensures that each person handling immovable property can rely confidently upon the statements contained within the registered. As a full and complete account of all transactions by which the title of the property could also be affected and secure the copies duly certified. Okay, so now we move on to discussions where you have to find out that the following agreements are valid or void. Number 1. Kamla promises Ramesh to lend rupees 5 lakh in lieu of consideration that Ramesh gets if Kamla's marriage dissolved and he marries her. Which means that Ramesh will get the amount of money only if he marries Kamla. So here we have to find out if the agreement is valid or void. As per Section 23 of the Indian Contract Act 1872, an agreement is void if the object or consideration is against the public policy. So here, this agreement is a void agreement. Moving on to the next question. Sohan agrees with Mohan to sell his black horse. Unknown to both the parties that the horse was dead at the time of agreement. Here also, the agreement is a void agreement. As per Section 20 of the Indian Contract Act 1872, the contract caused by the mistake of fact are void. There is a mistake of fact as to the existence of the subject matter, that is the black horse. As here, the horse which is to be traded is already dead. So, the agreement stands void. Next question. Ram sells the goodwill of his shop to Shyam for rupees 4 lakh and promises not to carry on such business forever anywhere in India. The restriction is unreasonable. As per Section 27 of the Indian Contract Act 1872, an agreement in restraint of trade is void. However, a buyer can put such a condition on the seller of goodwill not to carry on same business. However, the conditions must be reasonable regarding the duration and the place of business. It cannot be that he cannot carry on business forever at any other place in the country. So thus, this agreement also stands void. Moving ahead. Ramamurthy, who is a citizen of India, enters into an agreement with an alien friend. Here, alien means a friend from a foreign country. Such an agreement will be considered to be a valid agreement. It is said an agreement with alien friend is valid, but an agreement with an alien enemy is a void agreement. So here, in this instance, the agreement will be a valid agreement. Number 5. In an agreement between Prakash and Girish, there is a condition that they will not institute legal proceedings against each other without consent. According to Section 28 of the Indian Contract Act 1872, such an agreement will be considered void. As an agreement in restraint of legal proceedings is considered to be a void agreement. With this, we come to an end of our discussion round. With this, we would like to conclude by saying if registration of documents isn't made, the method of verification and certification of title becomes difficult. Registration of documents reduces disputes and litigation to an outsized extent. We hope that this lecture was helpful in understanding the concept of registration of contract under Indian Contract Act 1872. Please drop down your messages, reviews, or any other queries that you might have in the comment section below. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.